Shalom, I'm Kahan Tazadaq, and this is my book, The Plug. Crystal used this book, my debt validation letter from this book, and it saved her $33,000. They was unable to validate the debt and therefore sent her the title to her car. My methods definitely work. Let's hear Crystal's testimony.
When I got that in the mail today, I screamed. I jumped and screamed. I was so excited.
Can you give them a brief synopsis of what you've done? Because I remember you used to be on webinars, conveyance.
I just used the plug, the debt validation letter, and I sent it certified and notarized to the bank. And 2 weeks later, and I actually sent them the second notice on Saturday. But yeah, 2 weeks later, I got the title back.
Quick question. Crystal's already SBC, correct?
The packet in June. I filed the UCC-1 on June 24th, and I sent the three packets to the IRS, Janet Yellen, and Puerto Rico.
Yeah, so basically, if she's done it in June, yes. Yes, she just haven't sent a copy to the UCC division. So basically, yes. As you see for yourself, my methods work. I've been around for 15 years. You could actually visit my website, www.truedisciplesofchrist.org. Click the link below this video to purchase this book now, The Plug. Also, subscribe to my YouTube channel, The Deprogram Enlightener, and subscribe to Kahan Tazadaq on Rumble. Greetings, peace, and good day. My name's Kahan Tazadaq, and what I'm holding in my hand is a masterpiece. 720 pages, my book, Liberate the Oppressed. Various adepts have actually utilized the strategies compiled within this book's to discharge a deluge of debts. Let's hear from.
Oh man, to be perfectly honest with you, it's the best money I've ever spent. I mean, if the webinar was $1,000, I would have actually still benefited because, you know, I just discharged $30,000 from a big bank, a big pretender lender. So. Yeah, I mean, I absolutely love these webinars because I get a lot of the information I can't find anywhere else, and then I go back and check all the codes and statutes and everything that associated with getting this relief and everything. And you know, everything coincides with everything that you talk about, man. And you know, I'm extremely grateful. I mean, the thing is, man, when you go back and look at all the information. I mean, why wouldn't it work? Well, you laid out all of the remedies and everything else that associated with all the everything that you talk about. You know, you dropping all these gems on everybody and giving them all the laws and everything. And if you don't use it, that's your own fault because you know it's there in black and white, and you just hold them to what they're supposed to do.
So which method did you use to discharge? Well, how much alleged debt did you discharge, Ephraim? Was that correct when I said 30,000?
Yeah, that was correct, 30,000 for my wife's vehicle. We've also sent out two other EFTs that we're getting ready to send out our first notice within another week. But, you know, I think total between the three that we've sent out, that'll be about $85,000.
And so you was telling me something about after you done this, you went to where your wife went to your credit report, and what was there when she went there?
Well, actually, she went to get an extension on her what she owes on the car payment, and she was trying to key it in for an additional 2 months of they're doing forbearance on there on the payments. And it says, well, at this time, we cannot issue you a forbearance on the payment because it seems like the loan, the alleged loan is paid off, we can't give you a forbearance on it. So I was like, okay. And so
that's beautiful, man. That's beautiful, Yashi.
Yeah, yeah, it's crazy. And then she actually went on the website and looked at the account itself, and it showed zero balance on there, man. And I was working at the time, and she called me up, and man, she was almost in tears. She was so excited. So yeah, it is pretty amazing.
Shalom, brothers and sisters. As you well know, my name is Kahan Tazadaq, Secure Party Creditor, and this is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel, and please be advised. Everything I'm about to give you is strictly for educational, informational, entertainment purposes only. Please don't take this as legal advice. Over the years, I've been teaching about the Secure Party Creditor redemption process. Contract is law and law is contract, 1099 OID 1099A, how to beat traffic tickets, how to prevent foreclosure has brought many people success, eliminate credit card debt, raise your credit score, you name it. And various people has actually had success and had provided numerous testimonies. Over the last few years, there's been people popping up like C. Hauser that's watched my information. And they come up with allegations that people could purchase cars with a 1099A. So a lot of people jumped on that C. Hauser train, and they've been very disappointed. Not only were they filing the 1099A, they was filing the 1099C and the OID. Pretty soon, other people, popcorn YouTubers, what I mean by popcorn YouTubers, they just pop up and allegedly know this information. This is nothing to play with. When you're dealing with the 1099A, OIDC, and so on and so forth, you're dealing with feds, right? You're dealing with the IRS, right? You're dealing with the federal. So you have damn well better know what you're doing. And it became obvious that these guys don't really know what they're doing. And to lure you in, they say we're in this together. They're generally praying to a man by the name of Cesare Bozier, who's the second son of the sixth Pope of Rome, that they refer to as Jesus Christ. They haven't even done their thorough research in that. I'm not into the business of insulting anyone's deity, but Cesare Bozier, Jesus Christ, is a made-up character. He's about as real as Superman is, right? I mean, he was real, but he's not the savior. He was his second son, Rodrigo Bozier, who was the sixth Pope of Rome. Cesare Bozier posed for that painting that was painted shortly after the Renaissance, who was originally painted by Leonardo da Vinci, then later by Michelangelo. He existed around the time of a man by the name of Machiavelli, has a book named The Prince. If you doubt this, go and do research it on yourself, just like they didn't do thorough research on that. They didn't do thorough research on these OID processes. See, a 1099 OID, if they understood what it mean, you wouldn't have people going out claiming thousands of dollars that they haven't earned or millions of dollars that they haven't earned, and then they coming back and they look at federal indictments. Why? Because when you report these forms to the IRS, if you can't show that you actually pay these monies out, because when you do this, you're essentially saying OID is the original issue discount. You're returning the money back to the source. So if you're trying to OID $1 million, you're saying that you paid out $1 million that year. And if you haven't done it, the IRS will be knocking on your door, buddy. And if it hasn't happened yet, they just haven't gotten to your paperwork yet. I'm not trying to make you daunted. Because to do this, you have to be totally undaunted, but I'm trying to help some of you out from serious problems. If you remember a few years back in 2017, I warned you about Heather Tucci and this guy named Randy, who's actually doing time in prison still. And so now you have some new fly-by-night popcorn YouTubers that's teaching you this stuff, and a lot of you are going to end up in lots of trouble. So you have this other guy that popped up out of nowhere, Coach MT. I'm not sure exactly what made him a coach, but I could tell by the way that he articulates himself that he's just learning this himself, yet you're trusting this guy and you're paying him. Now, if you go back just a year ago, this guy was saying, oh yeah, the 1099A works. You could get a car with it and so on and so forth. Just go and watch some of his older videos. In fact, I'm gonna put a clip here to show you guys I'm not just making allegations. And I'm just going to use the fair use, just to use your information for educational purposes, so you guys could actually avoid this and not encounter these problems that you really don't need. And then there's another couple that refers to themselves as Jared Realty Investors. Obviously, they don't know. They're just learning, and they're pushing that same slogan, we're all in this together, may Jesus Christ guide us. Jesus Christ is Cesare Bozier. Really, you guys, I encourage you to check out everything that I'm saying here. Don't believe me. You hear Hauser say that? He picked that up from me. I would always tell people in the beginning, don't believe me, go and check it out for yourself. People that go and check it out, no one has ever come back over 13, 14 years with anything. You've never heard me change anything because I thoroughly investigated before I put it out there. These guys are not doing this. They tell you that you're doing things through trial and error, and you new YouTubers, you're setting yourself up for major failures. So without further delay, let's look at some of these allegations that these guys has actually made here.
And that is the 1099A, acquisition or abandonment of secured property. The other one is the 1099C, which is cancellation of debt. That's what I want to go over today, folks. This may be a long video. I don't know. It depends on how much I get into. But the man that turned me on to this, I'm not going to mention any names, but he showed me how to do this, okay? And his example was through automobiles. And what he was doing is he was taking these 1099As to the dealership, and he was buying one brand new car every month. He bought his wife a Cadillac. And then when he seen that he could do that, he started doing it every month.
Okay, so a lot of people ask, can I get in the group? I don't control the group. Now, if you're already in the group, great. If not, then, you know, I'm just learning in there. And then when I learn, I share the information with you all. But they say, hey, you can use this form for current times, okay? Just as it is, as you can see, there's several copies. All right, you got copy A, copy B, and copy C, okay? So these are copies you keep, and this goes here, okay? So I just wanted to have the screenshot or the screen share to show you how to fill this out. Now you can send a 10, you can use a 1099A. I'm gonna talk about the two major ways. One is to, if you want to pay something off, say as you want to pay off like an installment loan, like a student loan or a car note or a mortgage or a personal loan, then you want to send the 1099A form
along. So your name does not have to match. I mean, if you're married, your name does not have to match the birth certificate. I mean, your social security number is the trust. That's the SESTA-K trust. That's where it's not dealing with the birth certificate. It's actually coming from the social security number. So, you know, whatever name you have on your social is the name you need to use for the.
Kayla, yes, we need to submit the forms. Before you put in an offer, if you want to go the escrow route, that will save you from having to put a significant amount of earnest money down and possibly losing it. If you submit it to us, we'll send the OID and the 1096, 1040V, and the 8888 to Treasury. We're trying to get them out the next day after receiving them so that we can get moving on it.
So we have the guy, Coach MT, initially saying that, yeah, the 1099A works, you could get the car and so on and so forth, pay the student loans and so on and so forth. But then he comes back and he's doubting that. So let's look at his more recent video. And this is why you shouldn't just follow anyone on YouTube that's playing a guessing game. You very well may end up with a federal indictment. These federal forms are nothing to be toying around with. You're dealing with the IRS here. The world's best collection agency.
All right. So let us talk about the 1099A in that process. Okay. So before I get into it, let me give you a warning. Okay. If you are filling out the 1099A and the OID and you're not doing it correctly, okay, you're not doing it correctly, you will get notified from the IRS. All right. Especially if you're looking to attempt to get paid with the 1099A. Okay. Because what's going to happen is at the IRS, it's going to look like you made income that you didn't make. All right. The original issue discount document, the 1099 OID, is to document income that was made. Okay. So if you're looking to get paid with it, be careful. You could get notified from the IRS.
So now he's not so certain anymore. Now he's giving you warnings. This is the same guy like Mr. Hauser that was assuring you that you could actually purchase a car, pay student loans and all with the 1099A. Now he's urging you to be careful, which I told you from the inception. This is not something that a novice should be trying. And if you're not familiar with this process, not only will you get notice from the IRS, you may be federally indicted. And the feds, you're going to do 80% of that time. So without further delay, let's look over this stuff and some of the things that they've actually put out that you need to avoid. And you're not to touch this stuff unless you're actually literally being trained by someone this season and really know what they're doing. So now let's look at some of the things here that I want to point out. First of all, you cannot get a car with a 1099A because it's not a negotiable instrument. So at this time, I'm going to share my screen and I would like to cover exactly what a negotiable instrument is in Carnell Law.
Okay, so I want you to be able to see this.
So looking at this, we should be able to determine that a 1099A is not a negotiable instrument. It states here, except as provided in subsection C and D, negotiable instrument means an unconditional promise or order to pay a fixed amount of money with or without entrance or other charges described in the promise or order if it, A, 1, is payable to bearable or order at the same time it is issued first comes into the possession of the holder, 2, is payable on demand or at a definite time, and 3, does not state any other undertakings or instructions by the person promised in an order payment to do anything, any act in addition to the payment of the money. The promise or the order may contain I, 1, an undertaking of power to give, maintain, and to protect collateral to secure payment, 2, an unauthorization of power to the holder to confess judgment or realize on dispose of collateral, or 3, a waiver of the benefit of any law intended for the advantage or protection. And you can look at the definitions there below to determine what's what. All right, so it's clear that a 1099A is not a negotiable instrument. So why is Mr. Hauser, Coach MT, and this other group telling people that you can purchase a car with it when you in fact can't? It's not a negotiable instrument. And if used correctly, you could definitely anticipate what's coming behind that. So if it's not a negotiable instrument, why don't we visit the IRS website and see exactly what it is? Because many people like Mr. Hauser, Coach MT, and this realty group has misinterpreted the legal lease, and a lot of you people are going to end up into some serious trouble. Let's have a look at the IRS website now, and let's see exactly what this 1099A should be utilized for. Now, why is this 1099A file, according to the IRS? About Form 1099A. Acquisition or abandonment of secured property. So secured property will be something like an auto or a house. So this is why Hauser was telling you could go and get a car, but it is not a negotiable instrument. So it says right here, important parts, file form 1099A for each borrower. If you lend money in connection with your trade or your business and are in full or partial satisfaction of the debt, you acquire an interest in the property that is security for the debt, or you have reason to know that the property has been abandoned. So this doesn't apply to anything that these guys are doing. They don't understand the legal lease. Basically, what this is telling the dealership or the realtor, that if someone comes to try to get a home or a car, and that dealership or that lender, this alleged lender, by the way, loaned them money, then they filed this 1099A. It doesn't mean that you file it, Mr. Hauser or MT and so on and so forth. So that's why it's supposed to be filed. Now, you're going to have people that come with all kind of nonsense, but let's go ahead and admit it, man. You guys filed the wrong form, and you don't know how to use this 1099A properly. I've taught people how to use it properly, but I'm not going to teach you in this video because this is not what this is about. Now, I've been doing this for a long time, folks, and I've never told you something and retracted and caused people to get indicted or get into some sort of trouble. What I have done is I've warned you of these type of people that's out there that's causing you these nuisance, right? So now, why don't we hear one of my testimonies? Then I'll show you some of the frivolous documentations that they're throwing out there that's going to cause you a lot of backlash. So if you're doing it, stop it. Stop it now before it's too late.
Shalom, it's me again, Khan Tazadaq. You've heard the testimony from Crystal. You've heard from Ephraim Smith. You've heard from Sean. Hey, now I'm going to give you the opportunity to hear from Jeremiah Banks. This is why you know I'm the most successful secured creditor on the net. Attend my webinars. Get these books now. They are invaluable. Let's hear Jeremiah's testimony.
Live stream was essentially about me giving a testimony about some success that I had using the EFT method. So essentially I had a $2,000 credit card debt that I had for, you know, like maybe 6 to 8 months. I had inquired it back when I had my old car, and I had a lot of stuff breaking down, and long story short, I ended up, you know, using that, and I haven't really done anything about it. So, you know, it was just kind of sitting on my credit report. You know, I started attending the in-person seminars, also the webinars, a bunch of those, and, you know, just learning this information, and then finally felt like I was ready to utilize some of it and act on it. So, you know, essentially, you know, I just followed up with the process. I was able to, without giving too much, you know what I'm saying, because you do want to get the book yourself if you want to learn how to do this. But I did what I needed to do to get my EFT instrument, and you know, I drew it up and, you know, essentially sent it out. It's a process. It's not a, you know, overnight thing. It's something that you got to stick to and see through it to the end, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, if you did everything how you supposed to do it, you know, you'll get those results. If it don't work for you, then you got to look at yourself and see what you did, because if it worked for me, if it worked for Kahan, if it worked for all these other people, then, you know, you should be able to utilize the information the exact same way. So essentially, after I send my EFT, you know, the Kahan, he gives like a, you know, like maybe 30 days, you know what I'm saying, to follow up with your follow-up letters, unless you hear back from the creditor, you know, sooner than that. I didn't even give them 30 days. I gave them 2 weeks after their receipt of the initial EFT, and then I followed up with my letters. The first letter after the initial EFT was basically just a statement of account, letting them know, you know, from what I see on my end, the accounting is resolved. And, you know, people always say that they want to change their life or they want to be successful. But when you tell them what they have to do to be successful, they're like, oh, no, I don't want to do that. You know what I'm saying? A lot of people just, you know, talk and they don't really want to put the put it into action. You know what I'm saying? When you tell them what they got to do, hours and hours of studying, you know, burning the midnight oil, you know, getting up every day early in the morning, getting after, you know what I'm saying? People just talk. They don't really want to do what it takes to be successful and do what it takes to change their life. You know what I'm saying? A lot of people just be talking. But yeah, this whole process, you know what I'm saying? I got this straight from the book verbatim. I just took it and, you know, tailored it to my needs. If it's something that I didn't need, I took it out. If it's something I feel like I needed to add, I added it. And every single thing I got from, you know, Liberate the Oppressed. And that's this is just one part of the book. You know what I'm saying? It's so much other stuff in a book, you know, that I haven't even got to yet. You know what I'm saying? It's a plethora of information. And that's why you should, you know, go out and get this book and get the other materials and come for the webinars, seminars, if you can make it out, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, it starts with you. You got to want to change your life, you know what I'm saying? People want somebody to, like, hold their hand. Like I was remembering Dr. Han was saying, you know, some person was asking him for templates. You know what I'm saying? Like he literally got all this information right here for you, and you too lazy to type it up. Like that's beyond me. That's honestly ridiculous.
It's simple. Click the link below this video now and order your copy of Liberate the Oppressed before they all run out. Thank you for listening.
Okay, so what I'm going to do now is go over some of the frivolous documentations that they tell you that they've used to get cars, homes, and so on and so forth. It's all BS. The reason that none of these people has actually produced any proof is because it's just not true. This is not a negotiable instrument. Now, this Melanie person, I won't give her last name, she sent this letter in after she attempted to get a car from a dealership. So we'll skip down to the pertinent parts. Dear Mr. Newport, I'm writing to seek a remedy by accepting a 1099A payment to honor an agreement between Kendall Honda and me. Now, first of all, we can't pay anything. There's always a discharge. I want to make that abundantly clear, right? But she's using this form inappropriately. She has not been taught how to use it by Mr. Hoser or this MT guy or the other people. Today, Wednesday, March 16, 2022, I went to Kendall Honda and met with salesman John Smith, who helped me as I sought to buy a new vehicle. John was very helpful, answered my questions, and I decided on my 2022 CRV 1.52, blah, all of that, right? Just under 38,000. Now, mind you, Colin tells the doctors actually have people discharge these sort of debts with ease. But nevertheless, let's continue on. John and I sat down, and he asked me for my driver's license, social security number, and car insurance, and ready credit report on me. Now, to show you that this person wasn't taught correctly, she's saying my driver's license, my social security number, and ran my credit report. One of the things that Colin Tazadaq teaches you, and only you're going to learn this now, you're going to pretend that you knew it, is you always talk in the third person, because all of my students that become adepts know that this is not you. You know that Colin Tazadaq doesn't have, that I, man, don't have a driver's license, but Tazadaq has one. I don't have a social security number, but Tazadaq has one. And I don't have a credit report, but Tazadaq has one. The distinction has to always be there if you're going to be effective at this. Now, you could, that right there is big. And this is learned through experience. Then John returned and said, I qualified to buy a car, and he would let me know what financial options were available to me. He came back with an offer from Twin Credit Union with three payment options. Then I asked John if I could use my trust to pay for the car. Now, this is what she was taught by Hoosier, but this MT guy, right? John wasn't familiar with using trust to buy automobiles, because this is what they're telling these people they could do now, right? I explained to him that it isn't uncommon for people with trust funds to pick out a car and use a trust to pay for the car. You're exactly right if there's something in the trust, right? If the trust has assets. I then shared with Dorman that I have a trust, Social Security trust, for which I am the beneficiary of and would like to use my funds in the trust to buy the Honda. Interesting, right? I told John that when my Social Security, notice that when my, this person is a debtor. How can you expect this type of person to set off and settle and close a debt when they're a debtor? You know what? They haven't been taught right because their teachers really don't know. And they keep misleading you folks, saying, oh, we're all learning together, and you're still falling for this. Wow. Nevertheless, I told John that when my Social Security number, not the debtor's Social Security number, but when my Social Security number was used to run a credit check on me, you see, when you talk like this, this is why you get indicted and this is why you go to jail. I really need you people to listen up to me. You really better take heed to this. On me, that Kendall Honda became a trustee in my trust. And since I am the beneficiary, the trustee has a fiduciary obligation to benefit the beneficiary. What is the proof of that? Show me the validity of that. There's no validity that if someone runs the social of a debtor, that they become the trustee. And if they are the trustee, it is up to the trustee to decide what's going to happen in the trust, because that's who happens to run the trust, not the beneficiary. You get what's coming to you, debt, because you're a debtor and you really don't understand this process. So using the off-ledger funds in my Social Security, notice, my Social Security trust account would cover the cost of the car. So this woman is admitting to being the debtor. Debtors can't own anything, miss. You're a friggin' trust. You're a friggin' debtor. You're a straw man. You're a legal fiction. In legis. I would like to add that the credit report I signed was signed using my beneficiary's name. Interesting, right? I provided a copy of the instructions for the 1099A and 1099C and explained how the 1099A form is for acquisition, not just abandonment of secure property. And I said that I would like to use the 1099A and with it provide the 1099 OID. Now, let me stop right there. She's using an OID to show you that Hauser doesn't know what the hell he's talking about. This guy, Coach MT, doesn't know what he's talking about. If you allege, if you use this 1099 OID and you claim back funds, what you're basically telling the IRS is that, yeah, I paid out this money. So you have to be able to show it. So if you're just claiming funds out of thin air, you're going to be in trouble. These are actual IRS documents, folks. This is nothing to play around with. So the 1099 OID, 1096, and the 1040V IRS forms that the dealership fills out and sends into the U.S. Treasury with my complete 1099A form. I then said that in my 45 days or less that the Treasury would send the full amount of car price to Kendall. And then I could pick up the car. Actually, the IRS has an 1199A form, which can direct deposit funds in 10 days or less. That link is here. You people, I always encourage you to go and research stuff yourself, because there's stuff like this that's being taught out there that will cause you a lot of heartaches unnecessarily. Continue on. Since John didn't understand the process, he went to the finance department and bought Don Dodd, who I explained the whole process to. John was unaware of this perfectly legal financing procedure. I showed Jack in the instruction pamphlet an example of using the 1099A in acquiring personal property, which was a car, 2017 Honda Accord. Don didn't make the connection. Don suggested that I go to Twin Credit Union and see if they would agree creating a short-term loan in which I could actually have them file the 1099 OID. Why are they filing it? Why would they file it? Because they're going to claim back with this woman. Remember, who's filing the 1099 OID? They're claiming the funds back that they paid out. Understand that. 1096 and 1040V with my 1099A IRS form, as it would be better for the dealership. I do not want to go that route, as the dealership has the ability and the responsibility to accept my 1099A form as a trustee in my Social Security trust. I look forward to your prompt response to resolve this issue. Complete the sale using the 1099A form, a payment to Kendo Honda, and put me in a new Kendo Honda 2022. This has never happened, folks. Sincerely and without ill will, vexation, or prerogative. So there you have it, folks. This is the kind of nonsense that you folks are trusting on the internet and these pop-up internet so-called groups.
Today we're going to be going over the accepted for value process and why some people haven't been getting success. And Tazadaq, my husband's going to go over to show proof that it does work.
Well, we're not going over it. To be very brief, I'm going to show you a video that was actually uploaded years back when I done the acceptance for value on the car loan, because I'm consistently getting emails asking me, did it work? Of course it worked. I would not tell you something that I didn't get remedy in myself. You're not dealing with that kind of man. And it incenses me that most of you, you go out, you do this, you go in dishonor, then you're contacting me. Stop contacting me after you're in dishonor. If you want to try something, you should be knowledgeable on it first, especially dealing with this acceptance for value process. If you are not learned in this, you're going to get yourself in a jam, in a bind that you're going to regret. Once again, as I have actually told all of you, do not do the acceptance for value unless you're comfortable that you know how to respond on your own, which means you need to be able to comprehend contract law. You need to be able to comprehend offer and acceptance. You need to be able to comprehend the difference between the private side and the public side. You cannot, I cannot, no one can perform an acceptance for value if someone is actually on the private side. That means if someone has a little small utility company and they're operating on a private side, you can't A for V it. If you live in an apartment complex and it is owned by a private man or woman, as myself, you cannot A for V it. I would highly suggest that you go back and you have a look at House Joint Resolution 192. More importantly, Public Law 7310. I'm telling you the same thing over and over again, but you're just not getting it. First of all, for it to properly function, I contend that one has to be exempted from levy. And then once you are exempted from levy, you still need to understand contract law. Do not come running to me after you've done some A for V, you had no clue what you're doing, and now you got an offer that sounds like a threat and you go into bitch mode. It incenses me that so many of you are doing this and you're not learned in what you're doing. So, you know, again, I've uploaded a video just showing, because there's a lot of naysayers out there. The other problem is there's a lot of naysayers that telling you, oh, this doesn't work, it's all a scam. Well, it worked for me every time. So I contend that you do not know what you are doing if it's not working. You do not understand contract law. I told you over and again, get a good book on contract law. I recommend it, Brian Blunt. The other thing, get my books, The Infliction of Commerce and Commercial Warfare, We the People versus Despotism. Those books will be very resourceful and enlightening. But you just want to jump into things and you want to do it halfway so you're not getting remedy. Your remedy comes from within. So before we go into this video, have anything else?
So if someone is already a secured party creditor and they want to do an acceptance for value, but they're kind of hesitant about it, how would they contact you to get help to do it?
You got to be very precise of the words that you use. I am not helping them to do anything. If they do an acceptance for value because of the ramifications and the consequences that these alphabet groups have and may be listening or watching, I don't help them do anything. The only thing I do is show them what worked for me. And then if they want to do it, they're in the valley of decision. If they want to do and accept it for value, they're doing so at their own choice, at their own risk, and it may or may not work for them because they may not effectively apply the method that I apply. They may properly use the information or they may misuse the information, but I don't help anyone do anything. I just facilitate informations and give examples of what I did. I don't give advice. By the way, this is not legal advice. We do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel and then please be advised. Everything that I say in any of my videos, any of my writings, any of my books is for educational purposes only and informational purposes only. If you decide to use that information and it doesn't yield positive results, you do so at your own risk. Point blank, period. So with that, the number is actually on the screen. If you think you need coaching and so on and so forth for whatever issue you may be having, but just understand we do not give legal advice. I only tell you how I would deal with a particular situation. Understand that. So, you know, again, you're facing two major corporations, and they're known as Democratic Party and Republican Party, and they are manipulating your life. So now let's look back on this video that I uploaded a few years ago so it could silence the naysayers and those of you that keep asking, well, did it work on the car loan? I put the damn video up years ago, so of course it worked. So now let's watch the video. I just recently sent off an acceptance for value on my wife's car loan, and I'm actually waiting for the results. I actually sent a letter with it, told them that they actually had 7 days to respond or they're in actually dishonor the contract. So we'll see what happens.
These leaders that are set up over our community in leadership positions over our community, they're really doing a terrible job. They are ineffective leaders, and the world is going to find out. The world is going to find out very soon that these leaders are not really the true leaders that the Lord is sanctioning and ordaining to lead.
Book of Ezekiel, 37th chapter, first verse. Then you need to listen because you might learn something. Ezekiel 37, verse 1. The hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me away out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley which was full of bones. Verse 2. And caused me to pass by them and round about. And behold, there were very many in the open valley. And lo, they were very dry. Has been dead so long till they are now like skeletons. The skeletons has been in this valley for so long till the bones are now dry. Now there's no sign of life in these people. They're walking around in the ghetto. Can't produce nothing for themselves. Walking around like crack Frankenstein. Walking around like the walking dead. Men calling themselves niggas. Women calling themselves bitches. Men calling their women hoes. Because they're mentally dead now. They're spiritually dead. They're on a dead level and have a need to be raised to a living perpendicular. Now there is no sign of life in these people. As we continue with this prophecy, we will see what the Heavenly Father is showing Ezekiel is not a physical death, but a spiritual one. Now this shows us that these bones are not physically dead people, because one does not prophesy to dead people or their bones. Now dead people cannot hear. So we know that this is symbolic to a spiritual and mental death. With that of
dead, dry bones in a valley.
For the Lord hath a controversy with the inhabitants of the land, because there is no truth, nor mercy, nor knowledge of God in the land. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee.
The total due on this loan, as you see, was $6,489.09. So decided to always make it a little more. Constructed a money order right here, if you can see right here. Constructed a money order for $6,900. You know, just overpaid them a little. I always have a tendency to give them a little more than what they ask for. We go over to this document. Once again, you see, accept the value method written across the page. This was set off for $3,650. And yet another one, and I'm just going to show you three. I did accept the value written across the page. As you see here, this one was $1,435. Now, let's move over here. I want to cover this information up. A social and all. So, as you can see here, this is credit report. If I could focus in here. Get this here. Can you see that? Credit report. Begin credit report. Okay, this is a credit report. Don't you see the name? Yeah, I'll let you see one of the old addresses. It's there. Jamaica, New York. Okay. We'll move on here. Don't want you to see the company. Here is debt that was set off, settle, and close. As you see right here. It was 90 days past due. We go over here. The balance is zero. It was $1,900. It was set off, settled, and closed on 11/18/2010. Company. Here is another one that was actually set off, settled, and closed. It was actually only $99 owed on this credit card. As you can see, $99 zeroed out, zero balance. Yet another company here. This was the auto loan. I'll show you down here. Type of loan, automobile. Unpaid balance, charged off. Okay, over here, as you can see, let me find that for you. Here, as you see right here, it was $15,000 loan and it zeroed out. Balance now zero. This was accepted for value. 4/20/2011. And yet another from that same creditor, $500 loan, accepted for value.
So I'm going to be bringing this to an end right now. I do have an up-and-coming webinar. If you want to learn the OID process, the 1099A process, the EFD process, that the people that you saw that learned under Kahan Tazadaq had success with, be sure to tune into my up-and-coming webinar that's going to take place on Zoom. You could click that link under this video. It's going to be on July the 22nd and 23rd from 12 noon to 6 p.m. both days. Listen, question everything.
Go and research everything that I show you or anyone else shows you. Don't just take things for value. Research everything. Make them show themselves to be approved. You've been listening to Tazadaq. I approve this message. This message is not to ridicule anyone, but just to ensure that you have a safe journey in your learnings. Thank you for listening. Thank you for watching. I appreciate your donations and support to keep this channel going. Thank you. I love you. Have a good day. Shalom.